with us our resource person, Dr. Kripa Sindhu Naik. He is an assistant professor at Kalinga Institute of Social Sciences, Bhubaneswar. So today he will speak about the first block of the course Indian Society, that is composition and approaches to the study of Indian society. So this block has four units. The first unit is about religious, linguistic and racial composition of Indian society. Then next unit is about the concept of unity and diversity in India. Then next is about national integration. Here sir will discuss what is national integration and what are the different threats to national integration. And last unit is about various sociological approaches like structural functionalism and Marxism and subaltern perspectives to study Indian society. So now I would request Kripa Sindhu sir to start the session. And I also request to all the learners, please mute your mic. If you will have any doubts, please do write in the chat box. The sir ko discussion pare, we will try to make clear those doubts.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, madam. So good afternoon, everybody. I'm Dr. Kripa Sindhu Naik, going to teach the composition of Indian society and approach to the study of Indian society. So already the madam told the units related to composition, national integration and approach to the study of Indian society. But before going to teach all sort of things, I want to say something. This is not going to complete the course only. This is in the present period, the coronavirus situation is spreading all across the globe. The teacher's role is not just complete the syllabus, rather than it should think something beyond that. So it is more relevant to the Indian society, that unity and diversity. The people, whoever may be all across the globe, we should think positively and we should understand the thing better way and tackle the or handle the situation in coronavirus situation, which is very really relevant in present day. So now we start the composition of Indian society. So I think composition of Indian society, I give you one of the best examples, the body structure of a human being. Any composition of a human body is combination of different parts. Suppose like legs, hands, mouth, head, these are the part of the human body. So each human body part have a major role to play to function the whole body. Like this, Indian society also have some composed, some sort of part, like religious composition, linguistic composition, and racial composition. Apart from these things, there are others composition also have a major role to play in Indian society, like our population composition, as well as tribal composition, which is also play a significant role for Indian society. I'm audible. All the students can listen my voice. Hello?
Yes, sir. Yeah,
yeah.
Yes, you
so,
are audible, sir.
Yeah. The Indian society is very old and complex, plural. It has a very long history. It composed of different religious groups, racial groups, and groups having different cultural differences. In the long span of Indian history, various groups from different parts of the world enter into India with their own socio-cultural and racial features. So it's the best example is to, we can take say Indus Valley civilization. So far the religious composition is concerned, we have major religious people who have inhabited in India, which is all across, we have seen the eight major religious practice all across the India, eight religions peoples staying in India. Particularly if you see the Indian religious aspect, how much people are religiously, we are divided according to the religious composition. Majority of the peoples are Hindus, particularly the Hindus are majority of the people in Indian society. After that, the Muslims, then Christian, Buddhist, Sikhs, Jain, Zoroastrian, so many religious people who are living in India, but the major role of the composition is the how religious play a significant role in Indian society, particularly. So far the religious is concerned, when we are talking about the religious, it has a very important role in India, particularly when we talk about the different religious aspect. The Hindus, who is the majority, around 80% Hindu in India are the majority people are living in Hindu people are 80%. Then Muslim people also, they have a next highest group. But we divide the group, divide the people, minority and majority. Then majority is the Hindus people, or minority is the rest of the people, like Muslim, Christian, Sikhs, Jain, Buddhist. These are the minority groups. But when we're talking about the specifically Hindu religions, they are divided into different groups. Like particularly these peoples are divided into four groups. Those who believe in the Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwara, and another one is the Shakti. This is clearly that they worship to the God. Like this, Islam also, they have believed in different, they also divided into two groups, that is Shia and Sunni. So this, like this, Muslim, Christian also divided into two groups, that is Protestant and Catholics. So Buddhist also divided into two groups, that is Hinayana, Mahayana, and Jain also divided to Shvetambara and Digambara. These are the religious divisions of the religious. Religiously, they are divided, divided into different groups. So religious is a major role in Indian society, because if you see the Indian society, the first institutions came into the things, that is religions in the society. People believe on religions, whatever they believe in the religion, they are practiced in day-to-day society. That is why when they have take birth in the society, in the beginning, after the birth of the womb of the mother, they start the religious practices. So that is why we cannot ignore the religious aspect in each individual's life. So it has a major role in Indian society. Like this, linguistic composition. Language is what? Language is a medium of instruction, which helps to understand the other individuals, other thinking, other idea. Through language, we can exchange our view and idea from one person to another person, one group to another group. So this language helps us to understand each other, to believe each other, to exchange our idea each other. So India is one of the country which around 16,000, more than 1,600 religions are practiced all across the India. But only the 22 languages recognized by the constitution, and the rest of the languages not recognized, but they are using different languages in different regional area. Every language have some sort of important role in each society. Like in India, after independence of India, when India became a deep India state has been came into exist because of the language. On the basis of language, we have created the state. Like in Odisha, Odisha state has been created 1936 April 1, before independence. That is why Odisha is one of the separate state nowadays. So each language have a major role in a individual life, community life, society life, at the national level also. So far the language is concerned, it has a very significant role, significant composition in Indian society. Language, when we're talking about the language, we have a national language, a regional language, and a local language, which is very important role for individual and society also. So for the national language is concerned, Hindi is our national language, which speak majority of the people in India. That is why the Hindi is our national language. Apart from the national language, we have a regional language. At the same time, within the region, there are different local language also. So it has a major role for communication to each other, to exchange the idea, view within the community, within the society, within the nation. That is why it has a major role in Indian society. That is why it is a major component of Indian society. Then come to the racial. Racial, what is racial? Racial is one of the major factor in Indian society, because if you see, according to the A.L. Korver, a race is a valid biological concept. It is a group united by heredity, a breed of genetic strain of subspecies. If you see the according to D.N. Mojumdar also, if a group of people who by their possessions of a number of common physical traits can be distinguished from others, even if the member of this biological groups are widely scattered from the race. That means a specific race is depend upon their biological community, commonness, which is differently we can identify what is race means. So racial composition is one of the major composition of Indian society. According to Jane Hutton, one of the great sociologists in India, he has divided race in different type of races. But so far the major classification is given by Herbert Risle. Herbert Risle is one of the great socio-anthropologist. He has divided into race into seven groups. So first groups is Turk-Iranian, Indo-Aryan, Sino-Dravidian, Aryo-Dravidian, and Mongolo-Dravidian, Mongoloid, and Dravidian. So on the basis, the racial divisions in Indian society in the seven categories. Like this, B.C. Guha is one of the great sociologists. He also divided the race into six categories. So this race, according to B.C. Guha, one is the Negrido, the Proto-Australoid, third is the Mongoloid, fourth is the Mediterranean, fifth is the West Virginian, and sixth is Narodix. So these are the six races who are living in the different part of the India. So race has a major role in Indian society, because if you're talking about the race, how this race came to India? If you see the history of Indian society, then we can understand how the racer comes to India. Due course of the when the India was not independent, it was ruled by Britishers. Before that, the Muslim were ruled. Before that, the Persian were ruled. Before that, the Muslims have ruled many more years. So on that basis, different part of the world, the different race people came to India and ruled in India for longer period of the time. And due course of the time, they left also. But what they left it, but their races continue in Indian society. That is why we can understand how the race is very important for Indian society. If you see, how can we understand race is very important in Indian society? If you see the Indian society in a geographically, so we can see, we could divide the Indian society in east, west, south, north. If you see the different state wise, then also you can understand that how the different state have different role, how the different state have different development taken place after independence. It is depend upon the race. For example, if you see after 1947, when India got independence, around 15 to 16 state already had been already created. Then after now it is 28 state. But if you see the different state develop differently. So behind this development of the state, who is developing the state? It is because of the people who are residing in the state. The state where the people are residing, their role and responsibility, their work culture is very important for the development of the state. So that means some state is developed, some of the state is underdeveloped. It is depend upon the racial composition because of the individual individual hard work, individual determination of work, individual leadership work. That is the things which develop the state. So in Indian state, we can see how different state are rich and poor. It is depend upon our development of the state. So if you see the racial composition, some state already developed, some state underdeveloped. Why this state is not under, why state is underdeveloped? Because of that, because of the people who is residing on the state. If state is unless and until the people not develop, the state cannot be developed. That is why race have a major role in Indian society. On basis, we can see the Indian society have a hello. Joyce,
yes, sir.
Yeah. So actually, some little bit problems seen in the screen. Okay. So this is how the composition of Indian society. Now we are going to unity and diversity. Unity and diversity, it is one of the major component of Indian society, and it is one of the unique kind of nature which is distinct from others country. Unity means oneness, togetherness. Diversity means difference. Particularly when you're talking about the Indian society, India is one of the great unique culture all across the globe. Unity and diversity is one of the example for the whole globe. Why? Because Indian society composed of different religions, linguistic, racial, geographical diversity. There are so many cultural difference. Culturally, there are different people are residing in India. But thing is that apart from so many diversity, how the people of India live unity? That is very one of the challenging question for whole globe. There are so many people, so many religions, so many language. So how the Indian people are living very happily without any challenges? No doubt there is a challenge, there is a diversity exist within the different religious group, linguistic group, racial group, even though geographically differentiation also seen in Indian society. But when you're talking about the unity, when the threats came to the Indian society or country of India, we are united together to fight to survive our Mother India. That is why unity and diversity, one of the major component, the major importance thing, which should know each and every student and each and every stream in India, particularly unity and diversity is one of the major things which is teach in medical, engineering, law, because this is the unique kind of nature which is not seen all across the globe. It is only seen in India only. That is why, after all, India is one of the example of unity and diversity all across the globe. So far, unity is concerned in the religious point of view. When you're talking about the religion, how religiously they are united in Indian society. So there are 8 religions are practiced in India. So every religion have their own symbol, own principle, one temple where they are worshipping the God, and there are different founder also. But apart from there are so many religions, major 8 religions, how they are united. If you see this religious aspect in Indian society, the people of India who are take or who are converted into different religions, they are not other religious people, they are belongs to the Indian people, because they reside in India. Due course of the time, when the Muslims came, the Muslim religions came into existence. The Buddhist and Jain it started in India. They are from the Hindu religions people, and the Christian, when the British came, when the ruler, the Christian religions came to exist. So three major religions started from India itself, but the rest of the 2-3 religions came from the abroad. So far the religious is concerned, the people belongs to different religions people, but they came from one particular country. She may be Christian, he or she may be Muslim, but they are from Indian. That is why their culture and tradition is Indian, which is very significant to understand the religious point of view. So even though there are some sort of religious practices, there are sort of festivals celebrated different religious people. If you see, like the example of Holi, which is one of the major festival in Indian society, and we can say another major festival is Deepavali, which is another festival which is celebrated all across the all the religions people. Why? Even though we know that these two festivals is celebrated in the Hindu, but apart from Hindu, these two festivals we celebrated Christian and Muslim also. That means the most of the people like this festival to observe or celebrated happily. Thus it identifies, or we can understand how the religiously, even though they are religiously different, but their understanding, their way of celebration, their cooperation between them are very unique kind of thing. That is why everybody are happily celebrate the festival. That can we understand the unity of religion in Indian society. But if you see diversity point of view, so far the religious is concerned, there are the things which is happens every years, every month, every day also. We can say it is every day happens, like communalism on the basis of religion. So this communalism create divisions on the name of religion. We are at the communalism taken place. Communalism came into exist when the British rule in India. Before that, there is no communalism at all in Indian society, because British wants to divide rule the society. That is why they put divisions between the Hindu and Muslim. Then onwards, the Hindu and Muslims are divided for the major country divided after independence, that is Pakistan and Hindustan. So far as religion is concerned, which is related to diversity aspect of religious point of view. Like this language. Language is also have a very unique kind of things which is very important role in our society. So far the unity is concerned, so far the diversity is concerned. So language, which is a very significant in united the India, particularly when you talk about the Hindi language, national language, which is very important for Indian people, and we recognize as a national language because the majority of the people are speaking in Hindi. So which is very much important to understand the language. Next point is diversity. How the linguistic diversity is taken place in Indian society. Although you understand the Hindi is our national language, but some part of the India, they do not accept it. Hindi is their national language. That is why particularly they are not as accepted the Hindi is their national language. That is why it has created diversity in Indian society. So we can understand how the language play unity as well as diversity in Indian society. Apart from this, there are other unity and diversity, that is geographical diversity, geographical unity. Although we understand when the unity in Indian society in geographically, then if you see the map of India, the boundary of India, which is created by the nature, the three part of the Indian map, there is a Great Sea, which is covered by the Great Sea, and the another part is the Great Himalaya, which is standing like a big brother. So these four, covering the whole Indian society like a natural boundary, which is protects India, which is brings unity in Indian society. Today we are staying happy in the home. It is because of the nature. It is because of the nature we are safe in India. We are safe at home. Otherwise, the outsider likes China, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, outside country always try to create problem, try to create different challenges in Indian society. Due to the natural protection of the boundary, we are still living happily in Indian society. Is how geographically diversity also seen. Although Indian society is composed by different part. If you see the some part of the area is raining high, some part of the area is raining very low, like Rajasthan it is dry. So far the geographical is concerned, most of the time this geographical diversity create problem or help to develop. It creates problem for the Indian society as well as it creates unity in Indian society. If you see the different geographical location, there are some river flow from the Great Himalaya, which is cover up all across India. So this river comes to the Himalaya and go to the sea. At the same time, if you see the hill area, plain area, forest area, so it has very geographically uniqueness, which is different from the other state. Every state have a geographically different from other state. That is why the uniqueness of the geography has a major role to bring unity as well as diversity in India. So we understand how the unity and diversity play a significant role in Indian society, in the every individual life also. Then we go to for the national integration. So for the national integration is concerned, understand how the national integration has a play in Indian society. National integration is a process. It is a process in which we find firstly when the involvement of different group with various differences. Secondly, the groups try to adjust among themselves. Thirdly, they also try to be unified as a whole. While doing the adjustment and unification, these groups adopt various methods like cooperation, mutual understanding, sharing of value, national consensus, etc. That is why it is a sense of belongingness and sense of unity. Both are two important elements of national integration. It is very important for Indian society that there is a vast country. The country is a very vast, but still people are integrated because of the special cultures of the Indian society. But there are some threat for the national integration also, which is very much significant to understand. Why the national integration is threat, come into threatening? Because of there are some sort of problem like communalism, linguistic and regionalism. These are the major threat for national integration. So far the communalism is concerned, communalisms indicate the conflict among the different religious groups. In India, different religious groups like Hindu, Muslim, Christian, Sikh, Buddhist are living in different parts of the India. But most of the time, in the name of religion, they are conflicting each other. Recently, we have seen in Madhya Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh, which is very important thing to understand. Why this happens? Because of the politics. When you're talking about the religious, when you're talking about the Indian society, we cannot leave left the politics also. Who is created politics? Our politician, most of the time, they created politics in our life and created communalism, which is one of the challenges for Indian society so far the national integration is concerned. If you give one of the example, when the British rule in India, they always try to divide and rule policy. But the British are left. But the Indian think that this rule is again suitable for the Indian people. Unless and until if we are practice these things, we cannot be ruled in India. Like this, the politician in politician of Indian society, they always created communalism in India and created divide in India so that it will be hamper to the national integration. As because the British, why the politicians doing all sort of things? They want power. Because of the power, they want to get vote, without winning the election, they cannot achieve the power. That is why most of the time when the elections taken place, the politicians are came and they try to divide us on the basis of religions, on the basis of language, on the basis of caste, which is one of the major threat for the national integration. Although India is a democratic country, we believe in the principle of democratic, but still, practically, it is not possible in Indian society because of heterogeneity community. Because of the heterogeneity community, because of the people of different category, different groups, different race, different language, the politician take the plea to divide in different, in the different name of religions, in the different name of languages, so that the communalism create a problem for national integration. If you divide into different groups, different religions, different race, then automatically our national integration came into a great challenges. Like this, another important threat is linguistics. No doubt, after independence, India, every state has been created on the basis of language. And language, we already said, I already said, language is a major role in Indian society, and it has a very significant role for individual also. No doubt, the important thing, the language, which is on the basis of language, the state has been created, it has very significant, but most of the time, it created threat for national integration, as because we have divided on the basis of languages. We say most of the time, if we see in the local level, in the state level, in the national level, then we can understand how we are identify ourselves in front of others. When we talking about our anybody, we are asking about anybody, where are you from? We said we are from Odisha, they are from Punjab, they are from Tamil Nadu. So it is mean on the basis of language, we have divided ourselves. So it is a great threat for the national integration. Although we live in India, but when we ourselves address from others, then we are identified on the basis of our own state. Rather than it should be first, we should be introduced, I am an Indian rather than I am a Odia. But unfortunately, these things happens in Indian society, for which it affects the national integrity. Then third major threat is regionalism. Regionalism what? Regionalism is what? It is a particular region which is very important for everybody, as because regions is much important, as because we take birth in a particular region and we love to our native place, but so far the regional feeling which is developed in the people body and mind, it creates a great threat for the national integration. Why the people of particular regions are different from other region? It is because of the importance role of the development. When the concept of development came into exist, then we can understand how the things of region will be create problem for India as well as for the nation. Because when you're talking about particular region, then that region is a very different thing from the administration point of view. When we're talking about the region, some area is very backward, some area is very advanced, developments are taken place. So that there is no equal distribution of wealth and property so far the resources is concerned. That is why the threats came from the individual because of the particular regions. Some area, suppose for example, the capital of the country is Delhi. The Delhi should be situated in the middle part of the India. But unfortunately, it is in the top of the Indian side, which create problem for the rest of the people. How? Suppose all the headquarters is in the Delhi, and all the minister, all the prime minister, everybody who is highly authorized, they are residing on the Delhi. But best part of the area, you see the Kerala, Odisha. So these are the area which is neglected so far the Delhi development is concerned. How much facility and opportunity available in the Delhi is not available in the Odisha. How much transportation, communication facility available in Delhi, not available in Chhattisgarh. Like this, it create one kind of a feeling, which is create the regional feeling. We can understand the region according to our particular region, the feeling has been created. Like this, language, like this, religion, this feeling generated from the within the human mind, within the mind of the people of that particular region. That is why if you reside in a particular region and it is not developed by the government, by the higher authority, automatically feelings will be generated that we belong to a separate region, they belong to the separate region. Although we are living in an Indian society where the development facility and opportunity which create a barrier for region to region, for which national threat for the national integration came into existence. So the national integration is a one of the major challenge in nowadays. How? See, in the political point of view, if you see the political point of view, then you can understand better way. If you see the political aspect, then the most of the North India have a major dominating role in the political level. The south part of the India is neglected. East part of the India is neglected. Why it is? The questions come when you're talking about the national integration, it should be come proportionately equal. It should be given the equal proportion to every state. So far our constitution is concerned. Constitution also has principle, which is based on the secular principle, which is we should be respected the principle of democracy, but practically it is not happened. That is why most of the time the national integration is a great threat for Indian society. Like this, we can understand the different approaches to the study of Indian society, the structural functional approaches, Marxian and subaltern prospective approaches. These are the major approaches which is practically seen in Indian society. If you see the structural functional approaches, it is the best example we can take the caste system in Indian society. The caste system has been created in Indian society, and we structurally are divided into four groups. So far the caste is concerned, according to the caste principle, we have four castes: Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya and Shudra. So these four castes have different principle. They are divided on the basis of occupation, their way of life, their cultural life. Everything is divided on the basis of caste. And caste have a very important role for an individual life, and it determines the status of the individual, which is we can better way understand the how structurally it is created in Indian society, and it has a better functional. So when we're talking about the functionalist point of view, then we say as because the caste system have some certain principle and it has some significant role for which the caste system has been created. Everybody knows that how the caste came to exist in Indian society. If you're talking about the Varna system, before caste, the Varna system was practiced in Rig Vedic periods. The Rig Vedic period, how the Varna system came to exist? According to the own deeds, according to the own action, the Varna system has been created. But the due course of the time, it is changed into the caste system. And who is creating caste system? It is with the higher caste people. Who are the higher caste people? The Brahmins. Why they created it? It is because of their own benefits. See, they always try to dominate over the other caste group. That is why it has been created on the basis of caste, so that people can respect the caste principle, and those who are not respect the caste principle, they will be divided. So which is very important role, important factors of Indian structural functional point of view. For example, when we argument why this caste is divided, Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, then the some of the Shudra people will be demanding why it is created. They justify, as for the functionalist point of view, they justified it as because every caste have some sort of role and responsibility for function this society. That is why the caste system has been created. So for the Brahmins, divisions of work is concerned. For the caste system, Brahmin is worshipping to the god, Kshatriya is protection to the state, and Vaishya is the businessman, and Shudra is service provider. So these people are created, it is because of some sort of functions of the society. That is why the whole society will be function properly. That is the structural functional point of view. And so for the Marxist point of view, if you see the Marx is concerned, Marx always talk about the proletariat and capitalist and proletariat groups. The most of the time, this Marxian approach to Indian society is a very relevant, as because most of the people in India is divided. If you divide the Indian society into two groups, there are the rich people, there are the poor people. It is related to the caste system also. Because the structure has been created, who are the higher caste people? Definitely we can understand the Brahmin and Kshatriya. And the rest person is the lower caste people, or it is the poor people. So it is always the fighting between the rich and poor, which is for which the class struggle came into exist according to Marxian point of view. So always, if you're talking about the Marxian point of view, the resources which is available in Indian society, 80% resources exist with the 10% people, and the 20% resources exist 80% of the people. So that is why the rich and poor always seen in Indian society, which is very much stratified society in India. And it created because of the two major things. That is why caste, that is the thing, that is the caste system, as well as the resource distribution, which is created the max, which is created the alienation, which is created the differences, which is makes stratification in Indian society. Another aspect is subaltern approach. Subaltern approach is another major approach to study the Indian society. After independence, when India got independent, the government of India planned for the development of the whole world, whole India. It is not only particular development of the Brahmin Kshatriya, rather it developed for everybody. Why? After independence, when Dr. B.R. Ambedkar drafting the constitution, they rightly put the things in a judicious way, that everybody should be equally benefited, everybody should be equally treated. There is a equality and opportunity which is prevail or across India after independence. But if you see the history of Indian society, then always the history talk about the higher caste people, always to talk about the rich people, but the marginalization community people, the lower caste people rage cannot be written in any historical aspect. Why? As because the subaltern approach in Indian society after 70 and 80, the subaltern approach came into Indian society, as because the marginalized sections' voice should be, marginal section have also major role in Indian society. Their voice should be recorded in the history. Before that, they are the voiceless people, which is not recorded in the history at all. If you see the in history, so. If these things happen in Indian history, so that is why the subaltern, the ground, it is, we can say the ground approach, we can understand from micro point of view, then we can understand the real Indian society, what it is. That is why the subaltern approach is came into exist. So it is the subaltern approach, if you see from the, we can take example for politics. Politics is the one of the major example we can understand what subaltern approach means. If you see the, as for the our constitutional provision, everybody equally treated, everybody will equally important. That is why when the elections undertaken, there is a reservation policy, which is enclosed by the our doctor B.R. Ambedkar. Why? As because the marginal sections of the people should also represented in the political level. Then only they will be benefited. Then only they will be developed. And then only their society will be changed. That is why the marginal section will be equally important in the constitutional level. That is why the reservation in the election system also came into existence. If you see the Uttar Pradesh, is one of the state where the Kansiram, who is the one of the major role in the subaltern approach is concerned. Because this political party is meant for the lower caste groups, which is now led by the Mayawati. As because they are the Shudra caste people who have to be came into power through this approach. Their voice, their understanding, their knowledge will be recognized in the society so that it can be equally important for other higher caste group also. That is why subaltern approach is prevailing all across India nowadays, because most of the time, if you see the people of higher caste, people of lower caste, after independence, the inequality is, we cannot say totally stop. It is somehow, it is the distance between the rich and poor became come to closer because of the equality of Indian society. When we're talking about the education aspect, we get opportunity in India. The people of the India get opportunity equally in the educational level, which is not seen in the before independence, because the caste system is there. The caste system, only the higher caste people get education. Rest of the people, particularly the Vaishya Sudra, they are not allowed to the any education. They are not allowed in the temple. That is why it creates divisions in the society. But subaltern approach always try to given more emphasis to the lower caste people, to the marginalized community, which practically we can understand the what Indian society means. That is why this approach, from understanding of structural functional point of view, understanding of Marxian point of view, understanding for subaltern perspective, in these four approaches, if you study the society, Indian society, we can better be understand how Indian society means, because we cannot take a specific approach to study the Indian society. It has a different dimension. It has a different issue, different challenges, as because of it is a heterogeneous groups, as because that is why we have to study the Indian society in different approaches, structural functional view, Marxian point of view, subaltern perspective view, so that we can study the Indian society in a better way. That is why in our unity, now the Indian society, the one of the first unity which should be taught beginning, but due to some challenges, due to some problems, due to some lockdown, Madam Joyshree, Madam, somebody already started from the unit 3 or 4. That is why this it should not be like this. It should be started from the beginning. That is why in the beginning, if you understand the Indian society properly on this point of view, then we can be think better way how India should be developed or how India can be integrated, how in national integration can be possible. That can be understood very well. Thank you very much. Anything, any doubt, you can ask me directly. Thank you. Jayashree madam.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir, for this wonderful class. Sir, there are some questions from the learners.
Definitely.
I am reading out those questions.
Yeah.
First is, what is Indological perspective?
Indological perspective, that is very important, as because Indology means Indian concept wise. If you see the Indian society in Indological aspect, there are some concept of text, like if you say the India is a India is a country who is majority peoples live in, the majority of religious are Hindus. So contextually, if you see in Indological perspective, which is not included our unity, it is included, not included, but still it is have some textual point of view, we can understand how the philosophy, how the Indian philosophy are think. So for the text of in philosophy is concerned in Indian society, different text, like our, if you see the Varna system, Ashrama system, it has some certain meaning. That is why Indological aspect also very significant to study the Indian society.
Yeah.
Any question?
Yeah, thank you, sir. I think this is the only question, I think. Yeah. Only one question is there.
Yeah, actually.
Sir, another question is, what is communal rights?
Communal rights?
Yeah.
Communal rights, particularly it is came to communal means the conflict between two different community. The rights mean this is the conflict between two different community for different purposes. Particularly communalism is a mean for, we're talking about the religious point of view. But not, it is not only for religious point of view. We can take it a different point, linguistic point of view, caste point of view. Two community came into conflict for their, for which the communal rights will be taken place, which is started from the British period. When India was not independent, the British tried to divide Indian people in different groups, the and Hindu. That is, they put the logic. You belongs to the particular religion, they belongs to the Hindu religion. How can they live in it together? It cannot be possible. That mindset will be created, injected to the individual life, the Hindu community and Muslim community. Particularly the Muslim community came realize that the, if India get independent, how we can live together? Because they are the majority people, because they are the separate people, it cannot possible to live together. That is why we have to separate from India. That is why another state has been created. So most of the thing, still it is practiced in the local level, in the state level, in the national level. The communal rights taken place in different part of the India, which is very much significant to understand the communal violence, which is prevailing in each and every state. So communal violence, communal rights, particularly conflict between two different community, two different group for particular purposes. It may be religious, it may be caste, it may be some issue, but due to these two communities, two distinct groups, that is why they always rivalry to each other, to some specific issue, for which the communal rights undertaken. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Next question is, what is the Marxian perspective in Indian scenario? Can we relate the Jasmani system of Indian society in the Marxian perspective?
Yeah, definitely, madam. Marxian point of view, if you see the Marxist theory, then we can understand how the bourgeois class exploited the labor classes, the proletariat classes. As because they have the capital, that is why they exploit the labor classes. As because they have no capital, that is why they exploit according to their wishes. Thing is, so far the Jajmani system is concerned, Jajman and Jajmani, the Jajman, who is the, we can say the Jamindar. One example will give, the Jamindar always helps to the Jajmani who is working under him. The Jajmani who is working is always subordinated to Jajman. Why? Because of any kind of problems taken place in Jajmani family, so he first of all go and direct help ask to the Jajman, because he is the Jamindar. He can solve any kind of problem. But so far this issue is concerned, he is exploiting the Jajmani because he has no other option. That is why anything he can be done through Jajmani, as because he is always helping to him, he always subordinate to him. So whatever he has done for the Jajmani, it is because of the rich and poor. The question of rich and poor, for him, he always subordinate to the Jajman. That is the why most of the time in Indian society, the Jajman and Jajmani cases, the Marxian approach is the right approach to study the Jajmani system in proper way to understand the Jajman and should understand the Indian society. Ma'am.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I think
any questions?
Another question is, how can we relate the dominant caste concept given by M.N. Srinivas with subaltern perspective?
Yeah. Dominant caste is given by M.N. Srinivas. Dominant caste means, particularly if you see in Indian society, in the caste system is concerned, that higher caste, the Brahmin, Khetra, they are the higher caste group. But according to M.S. Srinivas, when the specific area, specific region, there are the group of people who is dominated over specific area. They play a dominant role in that specific area. As because their population is high, as because the group have a very significant role in the political level, in the authoritarian level, that is why they have dominant role in a specific region. It may be the lower caste, it may be the higher caste. It is no matter the Brahmin have a dominant role, it is no concern the Shudra have a dominant role. It depends upon the specific region, specific area, the dominant groups have a important role in specific region, not it is prevalent all across India. Because they have a major groups in a specific region, so they have a political power, they have a economic power, they have a property, they have a majority of the people. Their role is very important. Their role is very important for others group also. So they play a dominant role in that locality, so that they can do anything in any times. That is why it is, according to M.N. Srinivas, is a dominant group which is created by the particular area, that people are very significant for changing the system also, because they have a dominant role in a particular region. That is why it is very much significant for other aspects in Indian society. Ma'am.
Yeah, thank you, sir. And last question is, how can we relate the traditional Indian structure with social change?
Traditional Indian structure with social change.
Yeah.
We can understand the tradition and modernity. How we can different because of the changing circumstances. Change is the unchangeable law of the nature. So if you see the traditional aspect, the tradition of Indian society, and in the present situation, there is a hell and heaven differences. So tradition is a thing particularly, and due course of the changes are taken place according to the requirement, according to the demand, according to the changing situation, the individuals changes their way of life, thinking, belief, attitude, which is very much relevant to continue the society. So far the tradition is concerned, which is practiced by our forefather, which is not relevant in present society. It is because of the changes. If you see the if you give one of the concept of sociology, that is the cultural law, why this is? It is because of the conflict between two generations. So why this conflict came into exist? Because of the changes, the changes of the society. That is why the two that is why the cultural laws taken place in Indian society. In the present society, if you see the present society, we are advancing, or we are scientific development society, for which now we are technologically advanced, we have rationally advanced. So far the traditional is concerned, which is believe on the religious myth, which is no more significant in present day. That is why that it is because we can differentiate, we can understand because of the change, as well as we can get the education which is more relevant to understand the difference between the tradition and modernity. Ma'am.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Dear learners, sir has given a clear and detailed description about the composition and approaches to the study of Indian society. So, as we all know, we have different religions, we have different cultures, we have different languages, but we maintain the notion of unity in diversity in India. And this unity in diversity helps in our nation building, or it helps to maintain the national integration. Though we have a unity, there are certain threats or challenges like regionalism or communalism, which affect our national integration. So with this, on behalf of Odisha State Open University, I would like to thank you, sir, once again. And I also thank our technical team, also to our learners who have actively participated in this session. With this, we conclude our session here.
Thank you.